So this course is quite advanced, and it's about the asymptotic properties of non-positively curved manifold or symmetric, locally symmetric spaces. I will say what it means. Today's like an overview of what this course will be about, or some introduction to the subject. So it will be less formal today. Next week or next time, we start to be more rigorous with a more definition and systematic. But I will assume a lot of background. Sometimes you will have to. to read some, not a lot, but actually, I try to do most things here, but some elementary, basic facts about Lie groups or Riemannian manifolds. Maybe I'll leave it to you to read about it. maybe some motivation. So consider a dipolar space, Hn. This is the n-dimensional Lobachevsky space. So it is like, topologically it's like Rn, but it has a different metric, and the constant curvature minus one. So I assume all of you have seen it or are a bit familiar with it, but we spoke about it in the Midrasha, and if you want, I will say more about it later. But this is the constant curvature minus one, and a hyperbolic n-manifold is an hyperbolic. Basically a complete, if it's, I assume it's a complete, so it's always a quotient of this space. So the universal cover of the manifold will be this space, is a manifold of the form M, which is Hn mod gamma, where gamma is a group that acts properly discontinuously. And we know torsion, so gamma is the fundamental group of M, is isomorphic to the fundamental group of M, and this is every complete hyperbolic N manifold, its universal cover is this space, and the fundamental group acts via deck transformation on this universal cover, and the manifold is the quotient. So when I speak about, when I want to say something about the collection of all n-dimensional hyperbolic manifolds, is the same as studying all this discrete torsion-free group of isometries. I'll say more about this. I'll explain more about this. And basically, we consider such families. So we want to say, we want to understand the family of all hyperbolic n-manifolds. We fix n, 17, and we want to say something meaningful about all 17-dimensional hyperbolic manifolds, or all 3-dimensional hyperbolic manifolds. So one parameter that we have here is the volume. The volume of M is some positive number, maybe infinity, and it's a one parameter that we want to know how many information we have in this parameter. So this is like the basic question in this course: what does this volume tells us about M? So, like, suppose we knew that our universe is hyperbolic, and suppose we knew some estimate to the volume of the universe, what can we say about the universe only from this parameter. So can we say an estimate on how many black holes there is in the universe? So what is the topological complexity of the universe?
What is black holes?
No, I was speaking vaguely. Okay.
The volume is the volume that I think of the regular volume.
I don't know what it is.
Yes,
yeah, okay. But they don't read your mind. It's especially you. yes, there is the volume is well defined. It's a Riemannian volume. There is a Riemannian structure here. And it's also, we will say more about it. Also, you can use the group of isometries of the of HN, which is some nice Lie group, and it has a natural Lebesgue measure, called Hau measure. It is constant, and in this context, and you can use this to define the volume. So the volume is can be defined canonically, and this is basically the question. So let me give some examples. So let's start with dimension 2. In dimension 2, there is the Gauss-Bonnet theorem. Gauss is like that. Gauss-Bonnet theorem tell us that So what is in that case, a hyperbolic, two-dimensional manifold, a hyperbolic surface? It's something we can imagine like that. So it's like a donut with a few holes. And Gauss-Bonnet theorem tells us that the integral over M of the curvature equals, I think, 2 pi, the Euler characteristic of S. This is, if I'm not wrong, the Gauss-Bonnet theorem, but the curvature is minus 1. So it tells us that that the volume of M is minus 2 pi, the Euler characteristic. So the volume determines the Euler characteristic.
So this is true for all constant curvature two-dimensional manifold?
Yeah, this closed. And this is true for any two-dimensional manifold, not just closed manifold if you have no boundary. This is the Gauss-Bonnet theorem, so any surface
of constant curvature.
Not just constant curvature, but here K is constant minus 1. So this line is true not just for constant curvature. You can do it for the sphere. If you compute for the sphere, the sphere has a curvature plus 1.
But the curvature, if it's not constant, then how do you integrate over it?
No, it's the compound. Total curvature. I mean, it's mm-hmm. just a function from
the curvature. At any point, you have a curvature and you have a measure. Maybe I should write here dx. I mean, I integrate.
Yeah, it's for 2 dimensions. Okay, right.
It's compact, right? You assume that. Okay.
I suppose now it's compact. You don't need to assume that. And there are also generalization of extension of Gauss-Bonnet to higher dimension, theorem of Hertzsprung, and so. But this in two dimension it tells us a lot. So in particular, it tells us the Euler characteristic, and we know that the Euler characteristic of M is equals to 2 minus 2g, where g is the genus. And the genus is the number of holes. So in this case, g equals 3. In this case, g equals 0. And this tells us that the number of holes, but the number of holes characterize the surface completely. So if you know the classification of, let's say, orientable closed surfaces, there is exactly one for each genus. So this is for genus 0. This is for genus 1. And this is genus 2. So if you know the genus, you know precisely what is the manifold. At least you know topologically there is only one manifold surface of genus 0, and it's a sphere. And there is only one torus, which is the surface of genus 1, and only one of genus 2, and so on. And by the way, this is here you can put a constant curvature plus 1. Here you can put a constant curvature 0, And in all the rest, you can put a constant curvature minus one. So in some hint why negative curvature is more interesting than positive or zero curvature. So, and in this course, we will deal with negative or more generally non-positive curvature. But for now, you see that the volume, this one parameter, tell you what is the surface. If you have two surfaces of the same volume, they are homeomorphic. And actually, tell you, the Gauss won't even tell you more, that maybe you can change the metric here. You can change the Riemannian metric on the surface, and you can. This is Teichmuller theory. Teichmuller theory tell you that on this surface, there are many, many hyperbolic metrics. You can try to imagine something like that. Of course, all these pictures are deceiving. Because we try to visualize negative curvature, of course, this picture, I cannot embed a closed hyperbolic manifold in R2 and even in R3, but imagine that this is, that you have you can build another a metric which has a small geodesic somewhere that this one doesn't have. So at least there is the Teichmuller theory that tells you that there are many metrics on the same topological manifold. There are many hyperbolic metrics. All of them will have the same volume. That's the Gauss-Bonnet theory. So the volume tells you topologically, it tells you what is the manifold, but it doesn't tell you anything in dimension two about the metric. There could be continuously many surfaces of genus two and curvature minus one. There are continuously many. It means the deformation of this fundamental group. So there are continuously many. In that case, this gamma is a surface group. It's a fundamental group of a surface, which is a nice group with nice presentation. And it tells you that this group you can embed in continuously many different ways inside the group of isometries of H2, which is SL2R. But all of them will be of the same covolume. So there, you see some connection between the volume and the topology. But at least in this case, it doesn't tell you much about the geometry. It tells you about the topology, but not about the geometry. So this is a nice example. As I said in the beginning, I'm informal today, so I'm not defining things. I'm not defining curvature. I'm not defining. I just tell you what is this course about. Later will be more rigorous. So let's move on to dimension three.
Is it okay to still ask the question?
Yeah, sure.
So when you say continuously many, and we know that they're all homomorphic, you mean that with different metric or?
Yeah, different metric.
Okay.
You can for instance.
Non-isometric.
Non-isometric. Exactly.
So what does it mean? So continuously in the space of all of our metrics or matrices?
Yeah, you can. There is what is called the Teichmuller space or the moduli space, which is the space of all hyperbolic structure on a given surface, and this is a. This is a space of dimension, I think, 6G minus 6. So there is a parameterization. It's a very nice, if you want to read nice mathematics, elementary mathematics, read about Teichmuller theory. I will not go into it now, but basically you can decompose such a manifold you cut it and decompose it to a pair of pins. So in this case, you have each component here will be a pair of pins. Pair of pens is something like that. It's some people call it three hole sphere. So it's like and then from pair of pens you can construct hyperbolic surface, and every hyperbolic surface you can construct from pair of pens, you have several of them, and each of them has a given volume and by Gauss-Bonnet each of them you can somehow choose the length of the boundary. You can make the length of the boundary arbitrarily small. So of course when you glue two, they have to have the same length in the boundary. And also there's one parameter on the twist, how do you build it? But that's basically that's how you formulate the type field theorem.
And when they have different metrics, then they have different embedding always.
Yeah, the different embedding. So locally the metric
it has to.
Locally the metric that all has constant minus one. If you take a small ball, they all look the same as a small ball in the hyperbolic plane. But globally they will be different, and this amount to say is that the fundamental group embedded inside the isometric group of the hyperbolic plane, which is more or less SL2R, the 2x2 matrices of determinant 1, so it's embedded there in a, if you take two different metrics, you get two groups which are not conjugated. So the Gauss-Bonnet tells you something very nice. What's happening in higher dimension? So in higher dimension, you cannot expect that this single parameter will tell you so much, because the topological complexity in dimension 2, it can be somehow characterized by one parameter, the genus, the Euler characteristic. In higher dimension, there are many more parameters. For instance, there are different Betti numbers. But then there is a beautiful theorem of Gromov, or Balmann, Gromov, Schroeder. Basically, the proof of the theorem occupies half of the book of Balmann, Gromov, Schroeder, and the details are important. But so the story is that Gromov gave a series of talks in Paris, and Victor Schroeder attended these talks and wrote the book for the next 2 years, and half of the book is about the proof of this theorem. So let's say I will state it only in the hyperbolic case, which is much easier than the general case. But the theorem is as follows: there is a constant C depending on the dimension, such that for any k less than n, bk, this is the kth Betti number of m, is bounded by c times the volume of m for any hyperbolic n manifold. So you cannot say exactly, the volume does not determine precisely the topology, but it bounds the complexity of the topology. This is the theorem. And the general version, you change this hyperbolic you can consider any negatively curved manifold of bounded curvature. Or even curvature between 0 and minus 1, and even you can consider further non-positively curved, and this is much harder case. In the non-positively curved, you have to assume that the metric is analytic. It's not sufficient, otherwise you can construct Cantor example. But we will see in this course. At the first lecture, I will speak about hyperbolic or negatively curved manifold, and later I'll discuss a more general non-positively curved manifold, and these are much more hard to deal with. So the theory is harder, and the difference between non-positive curvature to negative curvature, for those of you, there is a strong connection between geometry and Lie theory here. So the difference is like the difference between SL2R and SL3R. So SL2R corresponds to negatively curved manifold, and SL3R corresponds to non-positively curved manifold. But we will get to that later. So this is a theorem, and somehow this theorem is like one of the motivation to say more. Maybe we can say much more about the topology of a manifold given the volume. So Gromov said we can bound the Betti number. But maybe we can say more. So let me give some examples. So for instance, another question, uh, you would like to answer, here is another question you can ask. Question, how many hyperbolic and manifold but and I may always assume complete and manifold have volume less than a given V. For a given V, I can ask myself how many manifold there are in dimension n and volume at most V. So by how many I need to say what I mean. So for instance, do I count them up to topology? If I do, in dimension 2, we know that there is only one in each possible volume by Gauss-Bonnet, so there is only one. So they grow linearly. If I count how many up to volume 1,000, so it's some constant, you know, 1,000 over 2 pi. So that's the number of them. But then I can ask them up to, not up to homeomorphism, but up to isometries. And then suddenly there are infinitely many, even in a given volume, by Clark-Miller theorem. And there are also other ways of counting, but this is one of the questions that we are interested in. I will say a bit more, but maybe some motivation from a different field of mathematics, from number theory. So, in number theory, you consider number fields, which are algebraic finite extension of Q. And a number field, similarly to the volume that there is this parameter which is called volume, similar to manifold where you have volume, for number field you have what is called a discriminant. Any finite extension of Q, it has a discriminant, and it's actually very related to volume, because if you learn number theory, you know that you can embed diagonally the number field in the finitely many real and complex completion of the field, and then the ring of integers becomes a lattice in this let's say n-dimensional space, n-dimensional vector space, and the discriminant of the field is exactly the square of the covolume of this lattice. So there is connection between a discriminant of fields and covolume of lattices, and actually this connection is deeper than what I just say, because later we will mention the arithmeticity theory and arithmeticity theorem of Margulis and Corlett and Gromov-Shen, and we will see that most of these lattices come from, or many of these lattices come from arithmetic construction, from number theory, and then the discriminant is more or less is related to the volume, the formula for the volume. So this question is analog to question in other field of mathematics. So in recent years, there is also there was a vast investigation of what's called asymptotic group theory. So what is asymptotic group theory? Asymptotic group theory, they ask a question like, how many groups there are of a given, if how many finite groups there are of a given order? How many groups you can find of size n? This is one type of question. Another question is, given an infinite group, finitely generated infinite group, like say SLN Z, you can ask how many group it admits of finite index, of a given index. So this is called subgroup growth. So you for a given index inside a given group, you can ask how many subgroup you have of this index, or of index bounded by this. And this first, the question about counting finite groups is related to counting group of finite index in a given group, because every finite group you can visualize it as a suppose you have a finite group which is generated by say two elements. So it's a quotient of F2, the free group. Every group which is generated by two elements is a quotient of F2. If the group is finite, then the kernel is a finite, is a group of finite index. The index of the kernel is exactly the size of the quotient. So in a sense, to count finite groups of a given two generated finite group is a question about counting subgroup or normal subgroup of finite index in the free group. So there is a question about relation about subgroup growth and growth of finite groups. And if you're interested in groups with certain properties, like important group, then you consider subgroup growth inside some nilpotent finite generated group, like the free nilpotent group of a given rank and a given nilpotency degree, or whatever. That's all sort of question, but all these questions are analogous to this question that I'm asking here. So because here I want to, one question is to ask myself how many manifold admits or in dimension 2 which are hyperbolic, or in dimension n, or in dimension and this is the same as I said before. So M, such a manifold is Hn mod gamma, where gamma is isomorphic to the fundamental group of M, and gamma is embedded. I will speak more about it. I will explain this relation later. Inside G, where G is the group of isometries of the universal cover. So this group of isometries is a very nice Lie group. And in a sense, if I want to count manifolds, is the same as counting subgroup inside this G, which are discrete and torsion free, and these are called lattices. So a subgroup which is discrete and the quotient has finite volume is called lattices. It's called a lattice, and to count manifolds is the same as counting lattices. So if you want, a lattice is a subgroup of finite covolume. It's the analog in the discrete group case of a subgroup of finite index. If you have a discrete group, the Haar measure is the counting measure. That's the natural measure for discrete group. And if you have a subgroup of finite index, it's covolume, it's the index. And here the analogy, so let's say a bit. Let's explain a bit more rigorously what I'm talking about. So, for instance, if n is 2, then the isometry group of the hyperbolic plane is more or less SL2R. Actually, I should write PSL2R, P because plus minus 1 acts trivially. And actually, it's not precisely, it's the connected component of this group. There is also reflection, very geodesic. So this is a subgroup of index 2 in the isometry group. In the hyperbolic plane, you can reflect by geodesic. Reflection are not in SL2. SL2 is a connected group. So this is a Lie group, a very nice Lie group, a three-dimensional Lie group of 3x3 matrices of determinant, 2x2 matrices of determinant 1. And gamma, this lattice, embeds in this group SL2R as a lattice. So it will be a discrete of finite covolume. So I will say more about lattices. I will define them and discuss basic properties in the first lecture of this course. But basically, the lattices, the covolume of this lattice is exactly the volume of the manifold. So when Yakim asks what is the if the volume is what I'm thinking of, so you could think about the Riemannian volume, and you can think about the Haar volume here. And both of them give you the same. If you normalize it correctly, up to all of them, the Haar measure depends on normalization. The Riemannian measure.
So how do you normalize it?
So the Riemannian structure determines the measure. So and the on G you don't have when you give me a Lie group, then I know there is a unique R measure up to normalization. But once you know fix one R measure, and then this will when you fix the measure, it will it will amount to say what is this constant C. So I can always change scale the metric such that C is one, for instance. But sometimes there is a natural choice of the Hadamard measure in the Lie group, and there is also the remaining structure on the hyperbolic space, on the symmetric space in general. It comes from the structure of the Lie group, from the killing form on the Lie algebra. So there is a natural way to normalize it. Okay, let's discuss it when we come to it. There is some normalization here. Anyhow, you see that a manifold correspond to a lattice in SL2R. A hyperbolic surface correspond to a lattice in SL2R. And if I have two manifolds which are isometric, they will correspond to two lattices which are conjugate. So when I, you know from covering theory that this embedding of the fundamental group with the group of isometries is not canonical. To embed, so this is the universal cover of M, and to embed the fundamental group in the group of isometries of the fundamental, the universal cover, I have to fix a point. Fundamental group is always with respect to a point and a frame and some direction in the tangent bundle, and then it will tell me how to, and then I can use this deck transformation and embed the fundamental group in the, and if I change the point or change the direction, it will amount to conjugating the group. I'll get some conjugated group. So counting manifold is the same as counting lattices up to conjugation. And so this is this question. So this is one natural question that we will wish to attack. So let me say a few words about this question before moving on. So first, there are several ways about the question. So I will say more question in the same spirit.
So if you change the point, then it's conjugate gamma, but also if you change the direction?
Yes. If you change direction, it's like conjugating gamma by elements in the compact group. So suppose the point corresponds to I in the upper half plane, to the root of minus one. And so now if you don't change the point, but just change the direction, it's like conjugating by SO2. So about the question. So by how many has different meaning? How many can be interpreted in several ways? For instance, e.g., I can count manifold up to homotopy. Or up to homeo. Or if you want, up to isometries. And actually there are even there are other ways. We'll get to them later. There are other natural ways. So let's for the moment speak about this one. So in dimension two we see that if I counting up to homeomorphism, the number of surfaces grows linearly with the volume. This is the only surface of genus 2, which means volume 4 pi. This is the only one with volume 6 pi, and so they go linearly. So this is in dimension two, but if I count them up to isometries, then even for this volume, I have continuous linearity. Okay, what happens in dimension three? So dimension two is special. So let's move to higher dimensions. Dimension three is also special. In some sense, it's the most interesting dimension. So let's speak a bit about dimension three. So in this case, first, I would like to remark some. I would like to mention some classical theorem, which is actually true in every dimension except two. And this theorem says that. Okay, we stick in this lecture to hyperbolic manifold. Later, we'll speak more generally. So two hyperbolic and manifold. Homotopy equivalent if and only if they are isometric. Two hyperbolic and manifold of finite volume are homotopy equivalent if and only if they are isometric. So this is a theorem of Mostov, and in fact, I should say Mostov and Prasad, and I assume that n is at least three. This is called Mostov rigidity theorem. It's much more general. It has a version in every semi-simple group, and the only case that it doesn't work is for SL2R. When you have Teichmuller theory. So it's the opposite of Teichmuller theory. So it's one of the most fundamental theorem in rigidity, maybe the biggest breakthrough in rigidity theorem, in rigidity theory. And it says that if you have two lattices in the same Lie groups, if they are isomorphic as lattices, then they are conjugated in the group photomorphism of G, which is a finite extension of G. So basically, conjugated inside G. So if you have two lattices in SL2C, by the way, the group of, as I said before, the group of isometries of of H2 is SL2R, the group of isometries of H3, it's also a nice Lie group. This would be SL2C. And again, I should do PSL2C. But so here, it's not true. You have two lattices, two surface groups which are isomorphic, but are not conjugated. And here, if you have two Kleinen groups, two fundamental group of three manifolds, if they are isomorphic, they must be conjugated. That's the only way to be isomorphic. It's a beautiful theorem of Mostov. The non-compact rank one case was proved by Prasad. This is called Mostov rigidity theorem, and it applies in much greater generality. So in particular, it says that this question of how many manifolds you have in dimension three and larger, it doesn't matter if you count them up to homotopy, up to homeomorphism, or up to isometry, it's the same question. But there are other news. Let's get a bit into it, and then we have a break. So then there is another theorem which I'm sure many of you heard about. In our Midrasha is the Kashdan-Margulis theorem. I will discuss it as well and give a proof. Kashdan-Margulis theorem says that the infimum, if I look at all volumes, infimum of volume M, such that, let's say M is n dimension hyperbolic, is a positive number. You cannot have hyperbolic manifold of arbitrarily small volume. And again, I say about hyperbolic manifold, but this is true in much greater generality, question mark ways. But so, let's think about it a bit. So imagine we consider one-dimensional manifold, so these are just circles. Circles can be arbitrarily short. Or if I discuss lattices in R2, which correspond to tori, so these are the copies of z square inside R square. You can homotate it and make it to be arbitrarily small, arbitrarily small for volume. So, but as we saw from Gauss-Bonnet, in dimension 2, if hyperbolic, you cannot. So this is the minimal, the integral of the granus must be up to 2 pi, an integer. So you cannot be arbitrarily small volume. In dimension 3, the Gauss-Bonnet tells me nothing, because the Euler characteristic is zero. So the Euler characteristic in all dimension is always zero. So the Gauss-Bonnet tells me nothing about the volume in dimension three, but still Kasdan-Margulis tell me something that says that you cannot have hyperbolic tree manifolds of arbitrarily small.
This is when we fix a Hadamard equation.
So when I speak about manifold, I said that there is a natural choice for the measure. The Riemannian structure defines the measure. There is a Riemannian measure coming from the Riemannian structure. There is the volume form is well defined for the Riemannian structure. If you speak about a Lie group, then fix the Hadamard, and then it's true. We will discuss this question over again. Okay, so there is a smallest actually hyperbolic manifold. But then, let's suppose we take V, which is larger than its volume, and ask ourselves how many manifold we have of bounded volume. And then there is a theorem of Thurston.
This one you will prove, Kristallmogulis?
Yes, this I will prove. Maybe also most of, in the compact case, I don't know, maybe we'll do it in the Midrasha. Most of the theorem is, at least for a compact hyperbolic proof, a compact hyperbolic manifold with an elementary proof by Gromov and Thurston, which we will show. So Thurston says that the following, there are countably many, so infinitely many, countably, actually not a hyperbolic tree manifold of volume bounded by 2.02. So Thurston tells us that actually this three-dimensional world is very rich. All of them, it's not Teichmuller theory. You don't fix one manifold and change the metric. You cannot do that by Merzler rigidity. For each, if you want a different manifold, you have to take a different object. You have to take a different topological manifold. So this is basically, this actually Thurston understood better than anyone many things, but in particular hyperbolic tree manifolds and he understood completely the set of volumes possible. So let me say a few words of how to do that. Again, it's today. It's a story. It's a story that I tell you about this whole field. And what we will try to do, where we will try to go, and later we'll be more rigorous and in, in future talks, all lemmas and proposition definitions should be well understood. If you don't understand something, ask. But today I'm telling you a story. So the story, what is this theorem come from? So what Searson did is the following. Take S3. S3 is the three-dimensional sphere, and remove a knot. Like the figure 8 knot. Figure 8 knot. So what is the figure 8 knot? I don't know how easy, how, if I can. Is this good? No, this is not good. Maybe now it's good. Up, down, up, down, yes. This is the figure 8 knot. You remove this from the three-dimensional sphere. So you get a non-compact manifold. So this has a metric. Has an hyperbolic metric.
Is it a knot or is it a field? Is it one-dimensional or?
Yes. I remove a knot. The knot is
one dimensional.
So I remove it from the three-dimensional sphere. I get a three-dimensional manifold which is not compact. It's not compact. I draw a two-dimensional manifold, but it's not compact. It has some topology. So you imagine this knot to so the knot is what sits in infinity. It's a boundary of this three-dimensional manifold. You get a three-dimensional manifold, and its volume is more or less 2.03. I don't remember exactly. This three-dimensional manifold has a nice fundamental group. The fundamental group of it, actually pi 1, is more or less is a finite index subgroup in SL2. Z of I, so this is an example of the arithmetic group inside SL2C. So I mentioned that lattices somehow come from arithmetic group, arithmetic construction. So this will be a finite index subgroup in this SL2ZI. So I will explain more in the future. So the connection between number theory to geometry that comes here in the construction of lattices, but you see this very geometric topological construction corresponds to an arithmetic group, and this group, this manifold will be a manifold of finite volume. It's not compact, but if you cut the cusp, so. In dimension 2, when you cut the cusp, you are left with a boundary which is a circle. In dimension 3, you are left with a boundary which is a torus. Imagine that when I cut, what I left here is a torus. And now I can try to glue a solid torus. And to glue a solid torus, there are two parameters. So the fundamental group of this torus is generated by two elements. It's z squared. So there are two parameters of telling me how do I glue a solid torus. If I glue a solid torus, it will become a compact manifold. And there are two parameters, N and M, that tells me how to glue the solid torus to this boundary. And Searson says that for infinitely many values of N and M, as long as they are coprime, actually for almost all values, you can find an hyperbolic metric on this manifold. So what you will get for each different gluing, you will, the way I imagine it, I get like, it's like cutting farther away in the cusp and getting different compact manifolds which are converged to this non-compact one. And all of them have volume which is less than 2.03. Anyhow, this is what I said now in 1 minute. It's a very deep theorem of Searson. In fact, I never read the details of the proof of this. So it's a technical and a beautiful theorem that tells you how to. It's called the Searson dense surgery. So you take. take a knot, you remove the boundary of a knot, and you glue a solid torus, and actually you don't have, need to start with S3, you can start with basically almost any three-dimensional manifold, and you will get hyperbolic, many examples of hyperbolic manifolds.
Did you say why they are not topologically the same?
I didn't say, but actually I said that for this N and M, if you choose different N and M, you can show that they have different first Betti number. Yeah, so they will be topologically different.
How exactly does N and M come in the Betti?
Okay, so basically I want to glue, the boundary here is the torus,
mm-hmm.
and I want to attach to it a solid torus.
Right.
Okay, and the solid torus is fundamental group which is generated by two elements, and I think one of them I will glue, the torus here also is the solid torus is three fundamental. Solid torus, the boundary of the solid torus is a torus whose fundamental group is this square, and I need to tell you how to glue this. So the gluing of this boundary to this boundary is determined by an element of the mapping class group of this torus. Okay, let's discuss it later. So the details of this. I'll explain later.
In general, can we just take different knots?
Yeah, you can. I think you can take different knots, and in I think basically any sufficiently complicated knot will give you a hyperbolic structure. So,
but this is the only arithmetic one.
This is the only arithmetic. Okay, I'm telling you a story, but so Searson said that there are continuously many, so the question, in a sense, you may say, is not interesting because how many? Infinitely many. There are infinitely many already for this small number. But still, it's not true. As Vikram said, this is the only arithmetic one. Let's suppose we count only arithmetic manifold. Then it becomes an interesting question, even in dimension 2. Count arithmetic lattices in SE2C. We will get to it later in the course. But after I define what is arithmetic lattice. Count arithmetic lattices in SE2C is a valid question even in dimension 3. In higher dimension, and then I'll say a few words and then we take a break. What happened in higher dimension, then this number becomes finite. So definition, O and V is the number of complete hyperbolic and manifold of volume at most V. And then there is a theorem of Wang. Beautiful theorem, I will show the proof of it. If n is at least 4, rho and v is finite for everything. Given v, there are only finitely many hyperbolic manifolds, there are only finitely many hyperbolic 4 manifold of volume less than a billion. So here it's a valid network question, how many? The asymptotic flow in group. If you can find explicit formula, it's the best, but if not, maybe you can bound it from above and below and so on. So this will give an answer. And this is, in a sense, analog to the question in number theory of counting number field of discriminant less than something. Or the question on subgroup growth, because this means in general, the isometric group of the hyperbolic n space is more or less, I mean, up to finite index, the group S O N 1. So the group of all orthogonal transformation preserving the form of signature n and 1 in R n plus 1. I will get to that later. And this is a nice Lie group, and you ask how many lattices it has of volume at most V up to conjugation. That is this question. It's like subgroup growth of this Lie group. So so that's a valid question. And so let's have 5 minutes break or 10 minutes? I don't know. Let's do 10 minutes. And then continue with the overview.
Okay, it's just a few. No, several.